Very good afternoon, friends. This is Sabyasachi Bharati on behalf of my organization, CMS Vatavaran. I welcome you all in a live Q&A session with a filmmaker. You all know that since 22nd of May, we are celebrating an environmental awareness online festival entitled Celebrating Biodiversity Lockdown 2.0. And this is a virtual festival focuses on biodiversity, climate change, and environmental issues. And our aim is to inspire and encourage everyone to take action even during the COVID-19 pandemic. And we have been supported by this in this green movement by our partners, High Commission of Canada in India, and lead the Green Change campaign of delegation of European Union to India. As you know that we had started a series of programs. We had done, you know, panel discussions. We are doing film screening every day. We are doing a live Q&A session with the filmmakers. We will have teachers workshop and a special one. We will have quiz competitions. And then we will have a special session with Oscar winner Swati Tangaj. So folks, please remain with us. And it will be, the festival will go till 8th of June. So today, as you know, that we are going to talk to one of the very prominent filmmaker and science communicator, science and environmental communicator of our country, Mr. G S Unnikrishnan. So let us welcome Mr. Unnikrishnan. Very good afternoon, sir. How are you?
Good afternoon, Oscar. Hi, fine. Thank you.
Fine. How are you? I'm fine. Thank you, sir. Thank you for participating in this session. So friends, as you know, G S Unnikrishnan Nair is a former additional director of agriculture in the Department of Agriculture, Kerala. Apart from he is a Malayali writer and a documentary filmmaker, and he is a graduate in agriculture from Banaras Hindu University with post-graduation in journalism and mass communication. He has contributed articles and features regularly in Malayalam and in English dailies and magazines since 1986. And he has published over 3,000 popular science and environmental articles, farm features, science stories, and he wrote more than 45 books. He has also scripted and directed over 200 television documentaries. Friends, apart from CMS Vatavaran International Film Festival, his documentaries have been screened in various international film festivals, including International TV Ecological Festival in Russia and International Nature Film Festival in Hungary, National Science Film Festival in India, Mumbai International Film Festival, IDSFFK Kerala. Mr. G.S. Unnikrishnan has won several awards for science and environmental communication. This includes two National Science Communication Awards in 2008 and 2017, four Beaver Awards in the National Science Film Festival of India in 2014, 15, 18, and 20, two NCRT-CIET Film Festival Best Film Awards in 2016 and 2018, Kerala State Biodiversity Media Award 2018, CMS Vatavaran Short Film Award, and three Kerala State Children Literature Award in 2005, 15, and 18, and last not the least, Kerala State Television Award in 2019. A great accomplishment, Mr. Krishnan. A warm welcome to you again in our live session. So, Mr. Krishnan, before we start talking about your filmmaking process and your film documentary journey, because you are a science communicator, and you were holding a very important, very serious position in the Kerala government and Department of Agriculture. And you had worked extensively about the biodiversity and its effect on agriculture. So I want to, my first question is, like, what do you see in around, what is your observation about the biodiversity loss? Because currently we are screening your film, which talks about how we lost so much of indigenous rice seeds, and only few rice seeds are there, remain with us, whom certain tribal communities or indigenous communities are trying to save. So what is your observation? What do you think about biodiversity loss today?
Actually, as we all know, one of the bad effects of Green Revolution was the loss of biodiversity. But that is in countries like India, that is very relevant. And we can see that a lot of biodiversity is being lost during the last decade, the 2-3 decades.
Sir, I want to ask one more, because you, in your opening, you said that we are seeing a lot of biodiversity loss due to Green Revolution.
Why, sir?
I just can you elaborate it a little bit?
Yes, yeah, surely. Actually, as an agricultural scientist, I have observed this problem during the last 2-3 decades. Actually, during the Green Revolution period, for increasing the productivity, lot of new high-yielding varieties were introduced in the field. That is the case of even the case of rice, and as far as wheat is concerned, rice is concerned, the all crops new high-yielding varieties. But during that period, it was necessary because we were suffering from a lot of food deficit. But the problem we forgot during that period is that we should have conserved the native biodiversity. Though we know, no one in the scientific community or the planners, nobody thought of the agrobiodiversity. And after the aftermath is that, if we take Kerala, for example, in Wayanad, we were cultivating about 60 indigenous rice varieties. Now nobody is cultivating it, this much numbers. Only about 10 numbers of rice varieties are there in the farmers. Other than some conservatives who are conserving 40-50 dollars. That is the same case in the case of millets also. In millets also, a lot of indigenous varieties there. The crop millet has disappeared. So the problem was that now we are seeing the good effects of these indigenous varieties, because climate change is a actual problem now, and we are facing a lot of aftermath of this climate change. The rain is shifting. One of the main problem is that we are suffering from water scarcity. So what the indigenous crop varieties can cope up with this water scarcity as well as this pest and disease problems to much better compared to the highly. The problem, but the limitation is that the productivity is maybe low. That is the main problem. But we can manage these varieties using minimum inputs like organic fertilizers. Even we can grow indigenous varieties, organic fertilizers. But if we analyze, for example, if you analyze indigenous rice varieties, we can see that there are varieties which can withstand flood. Some varieties can withstand this water scarcity. Some can withstand this grave problems like this rice bug or some problems like that. So then, other than this, the diversity of these varieties are of prime importance. Because as far as high-yielding varieties are concerned, there is no diversity in the test or use. Maybe some diversity is there. Yeah.
So according to you, how much, you have to give some percentage, according to how much percentage of these indigenous variety of rice, millet or pulses we have lost?
Almost 80%. Okay. Not only the case of this crop varieties, as far as indigenous farm animals are concerned, there are also these problems there. So the loss is very heavy. But now we are slowly realizing. As you know, the government of India has also taken up a step for conserving indigenous varieties of crops as well as indigenous animals. The same, now the scientists have recently started to think that these varieties are important. We should conserve them. So some things are changing. Some good hope is there.
Okay. So you said that we have lost 80% of these indigenous seeds or the varieties of crops. So right now we are suffering from pandemic, a very bad phase in our known history, in our life.
Right.
So according to you, do you think that this biodiversity loss, you know, is playing some role in this pandemic spread also?
Yeah, maybe. So some effect it may be there. Because if you think, for example, if you think about the tribal areas in those countries, I have done some films at Attappadi, that is one of the most backward areas in Kerala. That is a tribal district. Or four communities or tribes are living there. Now, if we observe them, we can see that these tribal communities were highly dependent on farming of indigenous crops and varieties, as well as rearing of indigenous animals. But as for, during the past three decades, there the same problem faced by them is that they are subject to urbanization. So in the past, they were living some kind of a life with a limited resource, maybe good food to eat and so on. Now they are going after money. So the problem is that the cotton lobby is slowly trying pursuing the farmers to take up cotton farming. And it happened so that during the 2002, I think, 2002, even GM cotton was being cultivated in this area, in these lands, which were previously having millets. So almost millets completely disappeared from the field. So during the last 5 years, a new program was initiated to reinstate these millets in the field. That is a success. It has completed 4 years. But the problem is that when they shifted from millets to cotton, their lifestyle also changed.
Okay.
Millets used to give them good health. Even if you go into some tribal colony, you could see women 90 years old, 95 years old, living a healthy lifestyle. Because they used to consume this millets, so also this grain amaranthos and all. But all these disappeared, and then health problems became very common, infant death and everything. But now slowly they realize that the loss of traditional crop has affected their health, and their social problems has happened. So now they are slowly returning to the millets. But the problem is that on the other side, these cotton lobbies, they are with money. They are saying that we will give money in advance. We can buy a lot of things. We can buy some non-veg, chicken, everything, and it will live a luxury life. We will give you money. You cultivate this GM cotton. What is the use in cultivating this millets and all? So once from one side, a lot of us visit there. So the challenge of the government is that we should conserve these varieties in whatever way possible by procuring the product with a higher price and all. So another important thing I want to add is that these were cultivated organically, fully organic. Millets are cultivated fully organic. But slowly after introduction of cotton, they started adding fertilizers, pesticides and all, and the soil became polluted. The pesticides and these herbicides were used in a large scale. So this virgin land, this virgin tribal land became highly polluted and poisoned. So that is one of the after effects. So when the lifestyle changes, that is actual chance of this disease slowly affecting. Then on the other hand, we are also destroying biodiversity, the large scale, by consuming wild animals and all. So also we are trying to invert places which are meant for wild animals, cutting the forest and everything. So in the large scale, these things do affect our living security and may lead to such diseases and all.
Okay. Mr. Unnikrishnan, now we come back to this film, your filmmaking process. So according to, you had completed your graduation in agriculture. Yes. And then, why you decided to do, you know, mass communication and journalism after doing, you know, agriculture? What was the reason?
Actually, I was much interested in science communication from a very early time. Okay. During even during school days, I used to write articles and all. So after study, I was very much interested in studying agriculture actually.
Okay.
After studying agriculture, I wanted to communicate agriculture to common people of the state and all. Mm-hmm. So then I thought that I should have some skill for that, for writing articles in journals. And mm-hmm. Then mm-hmm. I went for this communication, this journalism course. Mm-hmm. And that helped me a lot during my career.
Okay. So what was your first documentary, your first film? What was it about? Because you had made a number of documentary films.
Ah, yes. Yeah. Actually, I have, after joining the Department of Agriculture, mm-hmm. I used to work in the Farm Information Bureau. That is the Farm Information Bureau, the information wing of the Department of Agriculture. Mm-hmm. There was, I was editing a magazine, and mm-hmm. a farm magazine. And part of the time, I used to work for the video production. On video production, wing was there. Later on, I became in full charge of this video production. So we had a serial program in Doodarshan Malayalam. I have done almost 200 episodes of the program. So we used to go every week. We used to go to some farmer's field or some scientist lab or some research facility and do programs on this agriculture aspects. So first one I was covered, I still remembered, was about the horticulture therapy. Mm-hmm. Horticulture therapy was there. There was one family, one lady at Trichur, Kerala. She was suffering from this connective tissue disorder. Connective tissue disorder is a disease in which the joints will become very much painful. So she was dependent on steroids for curing this. But later on, some friend of her husband told him that you try this horticulture therapy. And they started farming orchids, anduri and all. But slowly, her dependence towards the steroids reduced. And by about 5 years, she totally quit the steroids. And now she is totally doing this farming. And she can, to a larger extent, withstand this pain, withstand or overcome this pain. Wow. So that is the first product I have done. So there was some science in it. I included some scientists' opinions and all, and the story.
So you extensively wrote about science and environment and agriculture and farming, all these things. So now come to the environmental or the science communication situation in India. What do you think? What is the current situation of environmental and science communication in our country?
Actually, as far as India is concerned, science communication has gained a lot of importance during the past 2-3 decades. Mm-hmm. As far as, for example, if you take, but the situation is changing also. During when I started writing in the Malayalam journals and this Malayalam newspapers, there were science columns in all the newspapers. There were weekly science columns, there were weekly farm columns, and there were weekly kids columns. So in all these things, we could write science articles. Science for kids, science for farmers, and science for farmers. So that was very, very favorable for us. So we could write a lot of articles, and every week I could contribute. And even in English, as far as English is concerned, there was a good, very good magazines like Science Reporter. So I used to write in Science Reporter also. So lot of opportunities were there. Mm-hmm. But the situation is not that much good now because everyone has stopped in science columns. So it is very, very bad. In Malayalam newspapers, no science columns are there. Farm columns are still there, but they have reduced the space. Actually, it was a full page column. Now they have given quarter of page on it. So these people, they are more interested in commerce and advertisement. So service to farmers, service to common man is a second priority for these newspaper companies and this is the people.
So
but the government sector, lot of things are there for favoring these for science communication.
Don't you think that one of the reason why science communication is not very popular among the people are that the most of the communication are done by the scientists? And they are not able to reach to the common people because they use so much of jargons and so much of, you know, theory and all these things that common people doesn't, you know, they are not able to connect to the article or the don't you think so?
Yes, that is an important, very important factor. Now, most of the scientists used to write in language which is not understood by the common man. But we can attempt a various type of styles of writing in science. For example, one example I could say is that one of my serials, radio serials, one Indian Medical Association, that was on this health communication. So that was a 17 episode serial. So the plot is that there is one shop, on a village shop, where these people meet in the evening to take tea and all. So they communicate with each other. And an Asha worker, as you know, Asha worker, the health worker, comes there. And she communicates with them. So some humor is there, some music, everything. So in between is small capsules. For example, or lady is coming with her child. So somebody is saying that Acha worker says this kid is very much anemic. You should do such and such thing. So others are contributing. So in such a way, you can put communicated messages in a more palatable way.
And what do you think is the situation of environmental communication in country?
As far as environmental communication is concerned, I think as far as Kerala is concerned, it is not very much up to the mark. Because nowadays, only magazines are publishing environmental articles. Except other than news stories, only magazines are publishing. And that are mostly written by journalists who have no scientific base. They approach subjects in a very peripheral way. That's a problem.
So, Unni Krishnan ji, what do you think according to you, it's the environmental communication in your area, especially in Kerala, is not up to the mark? So, the film festivals and forums like CMS Vatavaran, do you think that they can or they are playing an important part in this in spreading the environmental consciousness and environmental communication in the country?
Absolutely, sure. I appreciate the CMS Vatavaran for this the effort they are taking to communicate environmental related matters to the public. Because I think it is one of its kind in Asia, maybe in the world, who is fully focusing on environment. During the present scenario, the visual media is the most important media through which we can communicate matters related to environment, biodiversity, agriculture, everything. Because the visual medium has grown in such a proportion that there is no equivalence to it. But I also think that some short videos, short messages, they are getting more and more palatable by the common.
Public service message or the short films you are talking about.
Other than documentaries, we want short films because these short films are being watched much larger audience compared to the documentaries.
As we know that the Kerala has a very high literacy rate, at the same time Kerala has a very very intellectual kind of film culture there, where there are film festivals which are talking about so much about human rights and other things.
Yeah, that is right.
But there are how many environmental film festival in Kerala?
Oh, that is a good question. Actually, as you have said, Kerala has a good film watching culture. Lot of documentary festivals are there. You know, that's Kerala IDF is there. So a lot of people like watching movies. But there is no except some one or two small festivals. There is no environmental literature, no festival exclusively for environment or for science. So during if they are conducting, for example, Kerala International Documentary Festival, if I send a documentary on science or environment or biodiversity, that has that has to compete with the general document. It may be on human factors and everything. So the importance given to science documentaries and environment documentaries is very meager in Kerala.
Okay, so because we were invited to conduct Silent Valley Film Festival 2 years back in Kerala, and then we came to know that there are very apart from it, there was no film festival, you know, talking about the environment exclusively. Okay,
That was named Kadagam, the Silent Valley Film Festival. My this documentary was shown there also.
Yes, it was shown there. So coming back to the video audio visual medium, you were saying that this medium, according to you, is the most impressive or most effective medium to spread the environmental consciousness and the environmental communication to the masses in India. So in this changing scenario, for last 2 years we are working on working through internet, packed in our home, not allowed to go anywhere. Do you think that these kind of online audiovisual material will help for to this environmental awareness thing?
Sure. Yes, sir. I have during the past 1 year, I put all my documentaries on YouTube.
So would you please let us know the channel name so that the people that, who are
green,
watching can
green
go.
Green thumb videos.
Okay.
This is the situation that if some of the films have been watched by more than 1-2 lakh people. Because if you send for a festival, we know how many people will watch. Or if you show in a channel. So more and more people are watching through the internet. The only thing is that the documentary or the film should be more palatable.
Yes.
More presented in such a way that somebody will. For example, I have given a caption like an 87-year-old woman has made a forest on her own. So that film was watched by from around 50-60 countries.
Wow.
That's it. And a lot of good remarks from them. So that is a great media. This internet and YouTube and everything is a very great opportunity for science filmmakers and everybody.
Now coming back to your filmmaking process. So as we ask it to, all these our, the environmental filmmaker which we interviewed, which we had discussed until today, we asked them their process. So what is their process? So Unni Krishnan ji, what is your filming process? Like, we want to know about from scratch till the final product, how you go?
Okay. Well, I will explain it with an example. I have done a movie on this Attappady Black Gods. Attappady Black Gods and Attappady Gods in general. That was named Value of the Gods. Value of the Gods. So first thing, I used to travel to Attappady for about 10-15 years back. So I used to watch that a lot of women are carrying these gods and traveling in mountains and all. So I thought that this is a good subject. So I went to Attappady. I stayed there for 1 week. I went to all these colonies, all these tribal colonies, and communicated with them. Some local officials were there. So I understood that the relation of these tribals got is something different as compared to the relation of normal farmers. Because they used to love gods a lot. In every family, they used to sleep. These god kids used to sleep with the women inside the houses. They used to call them as baby. Vava means baby. Okay. These women, some women even used to feed milk to goat kids whose mothers have been lost, maybe caught by a leopard and something. Then they used to, in when during marriages, they used to give goat as dowry. So okay. Number of goats as dowry. Yeah. So that is a very good subject for me. Then I traveled to some places and some traditional medicine men. They used to treat goats and bulls and everything using traditional medicine. So I acquired all this information. That is the first step in my filmmaking. I go to the place, I do extensive research in the field, I acquire all the information and make contacts. Then I make a list as to which are the main points I want to give. Maybe there are maybe 50 points, 60 points, but we can include all this in a document. So I prioritize. I prioritize some key points. I will focus on such points. That is the second thing. Then I make a story. So how I will be treating this? So I thought that it will be better to make it like a travel log. So I am coming from this Coimbatore to Attapadi. On the way, communicating with some people on the way, where is the place? Then coming to I divided the program into you are well aware that the important thing in the document is that we will travel with the time and place and so. Show a single place, a single time, it will be very monotonous. So I first some one colony I took during morning, then evening from some other place. So the time zone. Then first we went to one colony during the early morning hour. Then they were taking goats to grazing. First the goats kids will be put in the house and the adult goats will be taken by this woman. They used to travel these mountains during this heavy this sunlight. This very very heavy work. You know? So we followed this woman. Most of the shepherds are women and Attapadi. So we followed the woman. We communicated with them. We picturized their life, how they are communicating with this goats. Then during peak afternoon hours, they used to sleep in a special type of hut that is called kudusal. That is made of layers of cloth so that there will be some resistance from heat. So after that, one or two hours, they will nap there. Then after all the goats, and they will come to the river. And this river is there, Siruvani. From there, the goats will take water. This woman will get freshened. Then they will return. By evening, they will be returning to the colony. So we fixate the whole process from A to Z, from starting to the, while they are returning to the colony, old women in the colony will be eagerly waiting. Because in the hills, there are the leopards are there. The elephant is there. So they are eager that their daughters will return safely to the, back to the house. So they will, so we picturize that. And another thing is that the goat kids will be eagerly waiting for the mother goat. So when mother goat comes, the kids will be crying, going after them, and that drinking milk and everything. So there's all life there. Okay. So then we fixed that. Then we went to then some amount of science. We went to the tribal part of the goat farm is there. Attapadi Black goat farm. There they used to conserve these black goats. Attapadi Black goats. So we communicated with them. What are the activities going on there? Everything. Then what are the specialties of these black goats? These black goats are evolved by the tribals. So the scientist, what is the scientist think about this black goat? What is the specialties?
So what I understood is that first you go to the place, you do extensive research.
Right.
Very extensive research.
Yeah.
And then you make a pre-shooting script.
Right. Yeah.
Appoint us what you want to include in film.
Okay. Right.
Okay. Then you go to the place where you have to shoot, and then you shoot extensively from morning till dusk, everything. And then you so you had taken the general stories, you then you go for the scientific stories.
Right. Yes.
And okay, so you had completed your shooting. Then after?
Then the last thing is that we go to the market.
Mm-hmm.
So this even though these are they love the gods very much, they mm-hmm. earn their living by selling this.
Mm-hmm.
So a lot of intermediaries are there. So these mm-hmm. Tribal people won't get good money by selling this.
Mm-hmm.
So we went and covered that and some problems with what is the problem facing with the tribals and all.
Mm-hmm.
Then thus we completed the program. After that, I used to sit with my editor, cameraman, and everything and discuss mm-hmm. as to which are the best shots we should include and what mm-hmm. is the final storyline. I made a pre-script I have made, but some contributions will be there. And then we got to go for the editing.
Okay.
Yeah. Yes.
According to you, how important music is for editing? We can use any music or you work on music? You give your time to come up with the good music. How you do it?
Actually, I think music is very important. But during my early documentaries, I had some problems with music. I took mm-hmm. some music from my internet after that. That caused a lot of problems. Mm-hmm. Then I realized that that is not a good thing. It is mm-hmm. always better to go for original music. Now mm-hmm. I took that original music is to be used. Mm-hmm. But that lot of music is there in YouTube and all. You can get some low-end film music. But mm-hmm. That is not a good thing. As far as possible, original music should be.
Okay.
And music is surely, as far as subjects like tribal subjects are concerned, music plays a very, very important role in mm-hmm. making the documentary much more, much mm-hmm. palatable and attractive.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
So music is very important and you work extensively.
Yeah.
Okay. So you start editing and you edit it. Then when you make film, when you edit film, what are the things which you keep in mind?
Yeah, that is one thing is that the subject, the core of the subject should be there. No? So no mm-hmm. deviation from the theme should be there. No beating around the bush should be there. It should be focused. Highly focused. Mm-hmm. That second thing is that it should be highly palatable and understandable by the common. Third is that the scientific content should be there. Otherwise, you can't say this is scientific. The problem is with some, I used to see in some documentary film as well, is that even documentaries with very meager science is mm-hmm. being projected as science film.
Mm-hmm.
Meager or no science in that are being projected as science. I think the science is, taking a science documentary, mm-hmm. you are describing it as a science documentary. Science, mm-hmm. but mm-hmm. there should be some profession. Mm-hmm. I think that the best proportion should be 30% mm-hmm. science and 70% visual science.
Mm-hmm.
That I keep in mind that a good science, content of science should be there.
Mm-hmm.
Then there should be some interesting elements.
Mm-hmm.
For example, in this documentary, just while we were shooting, I just saw one woman sitting mm-hmm. in front of her hut and feeding milk to small goat.
Yes, I have seen that very interesting footage. Very interesting. The lady is feeding with the water, with the bottle, milk bottle, feeding it to this cow. Yes, yes.
She was giving more milk to one particular kid. Uh-huh. Particular black goat.
Yeah.
That I observed and I asked why are you loving this black goat more? Then the mm-hmm. story came up. See that mm-hmm. During last 1 year, her mother was caught by mm-hmm. leopard and killed. Then she mm-hmm. took her and she looked after her. This mm-hmm. kid used to sleep with her. So that is some interesting element is there. So I put mm-hmm. tag that and I put it down. So that the visual, the viewers get some kind of some interest in the document.
Mm-hmm.
So I use that from points of view. Such points should be.
Okay, great. Coming again back to another topic that you we were talking. You said that women plays a very active part in the tribal society and in agriculture. So what is the role of women in agriculture there? Like, how they contribute? It is the mostly the women who work in the field.
Right. Yes, in tribal areas, like Attappady, one of the main problem is that men, most of the men are alcoholics. You know? So they used to drink.
Alcohol problem is there with the tribes.
Yeah, yes, that is. But they have actually Kerala government has banned alcohol shops in Attappady. But just near the border.
It was so severe problem that government had to ban the liquor.
But even then, just to get this illicit alcohol, that means made by local people, and also from bordering Tamil Nadu. So actually, they were subjected to a lot of these problems by the landlords then. Actually, in the earlier days, the tribals were the landlords.
Okay.
But settlers from Kerala and Tamil Nadu, they came. Okay. They just bribed these tribes with alcohol money, and bought the land with cheap price.
Okay.
Now the thing is that original landowners are laborers of persons who has come later. That is the problem. So most of these women used to get drunk and everything. You know? So the women has to earn livelihood. So they used to work in the field, just cultivate this millets, everything. They take gods for raising. So the importance of women in Attappady life is very, very important. But also, there is a lot of problems up there. There are cases of killing. Killing these women by their husbands who are got transgender. So many social problems are there. We're not facing many problems.
So women take a very active part in agriculture there.
Yeah, sure. Yes.
With the government, you were in a very senior position there in Department of Agriculture. Now you retired. What are you planning now? What are your future planning? Are you going to make some documentaries, or are you working on some book or research paper? What are you doing right now, and what are your future plans?
Actually, other than popular science, I have been writing children's literature for 22 years. So now I'm doing some books for children. On biodiversity and environment. And also I am thinking of compiling by farm articles and publishers and book. Then the document is I think that is a passion for me. The documents are very important. So I have selected some subjects related to this tribal area itself. Because similar to this indigenous rice variety, lot of indigenous tubers are there. Many type of tubers are there in Attappady and this Wayanad in Idukki district. So they are getting lost. This biodiversity erosion, these tubers are getting lost. Actually, they were the staple food of tribal community. During the past. So some persons are conserving this. Another person has recently won the National Biodiversity Award during this Biodiversity Day. So I am thinking of taking a document on him, and also the other tribal communities which are conserving or utilizing these tubers. The plants are there. Hopefully, after COVID, we can do some more good documents.
Really, very best of luck from CMS Vatavaran, and we hope that you will still making wonderful films and writing so many articles, and we really hope to see those films in CMS Vatavaran Film Festival. Thank you very much, G S Unnikrishnan Nair, for talking to us. Have a great day, sir.
Thank you very much. May I express my gratitude to CMS for this wonderful opportunity. I think that CMS Vatavaran Film Festival is one of the greatest film festival on environment in the globe, and I am really proud that some of my films are well screened.
So kind of you, sir. So kind of you, sir. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.
Friend, this was G S Unnikrishnan Nair, one of the prominent science communicator and farm film and agriculture and environment filmmaker of our country. He's from Kerala, and we wish him best of luck for his future endeavors. As you know, that we will be doing these kind of question session every day till 8th of June. So we hope to see you tomorrow again. Have a great day. Good night.